completed thesis research funded by LPSC ISRO on cryogenic treatment of metals, design and development of cryo treatment setup for pressure transducer diaphragm, effect of cryo treatment on the mechanical properties of metals, study of tribological property of polytetrafluoroethylene at cryogenic temperature, design and development of fatigue testing machine at cryogenic temperature, calibration of cryogenic temperature sensors down to 4.2K, and calibration of capacitance-based level sensors for LHE and LN2. He has published over 45 journal papers in national and international conferences. And also a life member of Indian Cryogenic Council. I, on behalf of Department of Mechanical Engineering, Coorg Institute of Technology, I extend a warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody.
Yes, sir.
You continue.
Over to you, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
I hope I'm audible, Bidappa. Bidappa, I'm audible.
Yes, sir. You're audible. You can go ahead.
Screen is clearly seen. Yes. Okay. Anything happens, just call me. Okay. Okay. Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. This is D.S. Nadi from Center for Cryogenic Technology, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. I'm going to deliver a talk on cryogenic treatment on metals. Before I start my lecture, it's definitely a very happy occasion for me to address you people. Somewhere a certain amount of unhappiness also is there within me because Coorg is basically a wonderful place. Nature lives, you know, nature from God's own country, something like that. A nice place full of greenery. If this corona problem would not be there, probably I'd be visiting your place to see the, you know, see the nature and interact with the very pleasant people of Coorg. Coorg people are known basically for, you know, good looks, well-built body, and they have contributed a lot to the Indian army. Anyway, I missed an opportunity, but nevertheless, let me, you know, forego this and make up with my web kind of a talk with all of you. See, the topic I'm talking about is cryogenic treatment on metals. If you can see at the right bottom, you can see celebrating 100 years. This is about the institute. This Indian Institute of Science started in the year 1908. And as on today, it has completed nearly 112 years, not a small achievement, it's a great achievement, and we stand number one in the country anytime with respect to academic or research activities. So feel proud that I am representing a very well-known and very reputed institute and giving a talk to all of you. Next slide, if you see, this is our department. You know, can see right side, you can see a vertical cylinder. On that, it is written Center for Cryogenic Technology. And you can see a small room kind of thing with a window and a door. This is the place where liquid nitrogen is supplied to users. So you can say this is the focal point of all the low temperature activities in the institute. So people from various labs, they come collect liquid nitrogen and conduct their low temperature experiments in the institute. I was talking about the history of Indian Institute of Science, but let me speak about the importance or significance of this department, Center for Cryogenic Technology, which is partly, you know, initially it was affiliated to physics department, where a great scientist, which every Indian should be knowing, Dr. C.V. Raman worked. So the privilege of this department is it has got a very senior colleague of mine, you know, a senior scientist who got the Nobel Prize, a pride for our country. So with these two backgrounds, let me start my talk titled Cryogenic Treatment on Metals. You can see here a sort of a boat kind of a thing on the top cryo treatment cycle, and you can see something like this, a straight line, and this goes sloping down, again a straight line, sloping up, and again a straight line. This is a typical case of a cryogenic treatment cycle. What is cryogenic treatment? Let me speak about this. Probably one can expect that in this world, new achievements, accomplishments take place due to ideas. It may be technical idea, or it can be political idea, it can be, you know, culinary art, it can be dress design or anything for that matter. It is some idea. It may be right or wrong, it's going to be the future which is going to decide, but some curiosities. For example, I can think about the runway of a plane taking off. I start imagining, whether right or wrong, that's a different story. Instead of a long runway, if there can be a vertical lift of the aircraft, it changes its direction and goes to any place, so that so much of space, so much of runway, so much of fuel, so many things are saved. You know, it can be foolish idea for me at the moment, but it can be realistic, something like that. On the same lines, let me talk about the domestic situation. You have got a refrigerator at home, which was a luxury about 30 to 40 years back. But now every household, and it has got, they've got a refrigerator. What is the reason why you should have a refrigerator? Because you keep milk, you keep vegetables, you keep fruits, meat, egg, so that the useful life of these items, these eateries, they get extended. So, on the same lines, Dr. Randolph Barron is known as the father of, what I'm saying is, he has written a fantastic book on cryogenic, Introduction to Cryogenic Engineering. He's known as father of cryogenic engineering. In the year somewhere in 1985 or so, he got a peculiar idea of, what about if we keep vegetables in the fridge, the life extends. Useful life extent, then how about, if that is the case, then how about keeping metals, non-living things, into liquid nitrogen, in the cryogenic temperature, extend it for a long time and see what are the effects. This was kind of a curiosity. So what he did, he collected so many items from various people around him. For example, it could have been a knife from the kitchen. It could have been a shaving blade from a colleague. It could have been the guitar string. Then cutting tools and all the things, he dipped them into liquid nitrogen where the temperature would go down to 77 Kelvin. Then it was kept in the temperature for about 24 hours and slowly warmed up to room temperature. Then see the effect. So this is what he carried out, called as cryo treatment process. A typical cryo treatment cycle or cryo treatment process consists of gradually taking down the material to cryogenic temperature. Normally, we talk about liquid nitrogen temperature. And as you can appreciate, because already people have been giving lectures, my seniors have given lectures, cryogenics means temperatures below 123 Kelvin and down. So take a material, take it to cryogenic temperature and gradually in 2 to 3 hours, allow it to remain in the temperature for extended length of time, say about 24 hours, and gradually warm up to room temperature, and it comes to room temperature, and now you can see what are the changes. So one thing you can see, left side the slope is somewhat different, right side the slope is totally different. The reason is like this: when you want to take a material to cryogenic temperature, you're not going to dip into liquid nitrogen bath, which is having a temperature of 77 Kelvin, but to gradually cool it down. Allow it to remain that temperature for a long time and slowly, slowly warm up to come to room temperature. So if cooling time is going to be 3 hours, warming time it will be around 9 hours. So effectively, if I'm going for a 24 hours cryo treatment cycle, so 24 plus 3 left side and 9 hours that side, 24 plus 9, 33 plus 3, 36. It's a 36 hours activity. So supposing I start the cryogenic treatment cycle on Monday morning at 8 o'clock, it will be over on Tuesday. So it's going to be a one day activity, spending sleepless night to take care of liquid nitrogen supply to maintain the temperature. So effectively, what I'm saying is cryo treatment cycle consists of taking the material to low temperature using liquid nitrogen down to 77 Kelvin, soaking them in the temperature for a good length of time and slowly gradually warming them. So the whole process can be divided into three phases. One is cool down period, second one is soak period, third one is warm up period. Let us understand one thing. Soak means, it doesn't mean it's being soaking the clothes in the water. It's not like that. It's not a wet process, just exposing. It could have been, the correct word could have been exposure period, but soaking means allowing the materials to remain at the temperature for a good length of time. So with this background, let me go ahead with my fourth slide. Effects of cryogenic treatment. You can coin the word, cryo treatment, cryogenic treatment and or cryo treatment. So you can see some bullets, about six, five bullets. Everything speaks about the significance of cryogenic treatment. So transformation, first of all, when you talk about cryogenic treatment, essentially normally we speak about steels only. So transformation of soft austenite structure to hard and strong martensite structure. This is normally with respect to steel material. And most of engineering applications, we talk about only steel. So in cryogenic treatment, probably if you are coming across, if you're familiar with the triple C curves or TTT diagrams, double C curves, when steel is taken to high temperature and cooled down to low temperature in a very fast manner, the soft, tough ductile constituent gets converted into a hard and strong martensite structure. Second one is, when you expose the material to low temperature, cryogenic temperature, in the case of steels, hard and fine carbide particles are precipitated, which are going to occupy, migrate inside the atomic, inside the metal structure, occupied wherever there is a gap or where there is a void, and fill up the entire volume. Thirdly, cryogenic treatment makes the realignment and formation of a strong, dense, and coherent crystal structure. I can put the analogy like this. You have got a copper block, and a copper block has got a coefficient of linear expansion, coefficient of volumetric expansion also. So if the temperature increases, the volume of copper block increases, and the temperature is brought down, the volume should decrease. Now in this cryogenic treatment, whether it comes to steel or copper or aluminum or any material, metal for that matter, when the temperature is brought down, the metal shrinks. When the metal shrinks, the atoms come closer to each other, they get locked with each other, and once the material is taken up to room temperature, these locked atoms, they do not release themselves, and hence it forms a strong and dense coherent crystal structure. Thirdly, and my fourth point is like this, the residual stresses and micro crack propagation are minimized or they are reduced. The reason is, these carbide particles, steel, I'm talking about steel, they fill up the voids, they fill up the voids and gaps, they make the entire structure very much strong. And when the atoms are locked together at cryogenic temperature, it, if there is a crack, it gets filled up. And if this crack is filled up, it's not possible to, even if it comes to room temperature, the lock remains intact and the micro crack propagation can be avoided. Then the beauty of cryogenic treatment is, whatever happens doesn't happen to the external surface. It goes to the center. It's not a surface treatment process. So what changes it takes place, whether austenite conversion to martensite, or talking about carbide precipitation, or formation of a strong, dense, and coherent structure, it is the entire material. So it's basically a volumetric process. So with these things, what we have to see is, what are the changes that we can expect? Let me start from the kitchen. The knife which was used to cut the vegetables, normally what happens is, we cut the vegetables and after 2 to 3 months, you are cutting the vegetables, but the effectiveness or the effect, if they mean the knife has become a bit blunt. What you do? Then you go to a sharpener, and the knife is sharpened. Again, it can be used for again good length of time. So if it can be used for 3 months, sharpen it again, use it for 3 months. So we call it as the life of the knife. So here, if you take the knife and give it a cryogenic treatment, which could be used for 3 months continuously, now that sharpness can be retained for 6 to 8 months. Or the shaving blade. Shaving blade, after some time it becomes blunt. We normally change the shaving blade, but if it is exposed to cryogenic treatment process, its life increases. So that the razor blade, which could be discarded after a month, it can be used for 3 to 4 times. The life increases. The same thing happened with the case of guitar strings also. It normally, you know, after a certain time, you know, it has to be tightened, but in the case of the wire which was exposed to cryogenic treatment, it retains its musical properties, its note, and you know, that metallic sound. So there are advantages of cryogenic treatment. So various fields, but essentially I'm talking about, because it's an engineering subject, I'm talking about what are the changes or what are the applications of cryogenic treatment to the materials around us, whether it comes to physical properties or electrical properties or mechanical properties, what are the changes that take place after cryogenic treatment. So I would like to start like this. Cryogenic treatment is a process where a material is exposed to cryogenic temperature, a low temperature of 77 Kelvin and somewhat in that temperature zone, soaking or allowing it to remain at that temperature for a good length of time, 24 hours or 36 hours or 18 hours, and gradually coming to room temperature. So now let us see what I'm talking about. Steel. So when you talk about steel, one is austenite steel, second one is martensite steel. So when you talk about steel, basically it contains two things, austenite as well as martensite. SS304, SS316, SS304L, anything like that. So now austenite is a soft material which is having face-centered cubic lattice. This is soft and ductile. This is non-magnetic. You can see on each face of the unit cell, there is a atom. Martensite, it is body-centered tetragonal lattice structure. It's called as BCT. And it is a strong, it is hard, where the sides are not equal. A is equal to A, but it's not equal to C. So slightly elongated in the vertical direction. So this is body-centered tetragonal lattice structure. So austenite is soft and ductile. You can think about copper or aluminum, gold, silver. Whereas the martensite, you can think about a strong and hard, something like steel or a titanium, like that for that matter. So if you see here, what happens if you think about the cubic structure of a unit cell? It is going to be like this. You expect everything to be uniform. So when you see a martensite, it is a body-centered tetragonal lattice structure. And when this unit cell gets repeated in X direction, Y direction, Z direction, it gives rise to the atomic structure and speaks about the structure, which is somewhat stronger. Austenite, you can see here, the atoms are located at 8 corners, and at this, on each face, hemisphere, there are many hemisphere. So I mean, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all the 6 faces, it has got hemispheres. And if there is another unit cell which is coming in contact with this, so it becomes a complete sphere. So one complete atom is formed. So here, austenite, there are more number of possibilities for the atoms to come in contact with each other. Because the atoms are coming in contact with each other, normally it is possible to break it easily, and also the thermal conductivity, electrical conductivity is somewhat better compared to martensitic materials. As I was telling, during cryogenic treatment, carbide particles are precipitated. What are carbide particles? They're hard carbide particles of about 2 micron in a diameter roughly. And these carbide particles, Fe3, they can move everywhere and occupy the voids or gaps, or they can fill up the micro cracks. You can see there are two figures, there are two photographs, metallurgical photographs. Left side, which is not cryotreated, but still there are carbides. One or two, you can see some here and there, whereas the right one, carbide particles are released after cryogenic treatment and they are spread to the entire volume. So when cryogenic treatment is carried out on a metal, I'm talking about steel, carbide particles, they fill up the voids, they fill up the micro cracks, and the whole atomic structure becomes strong and hard. And that's the reason the tool life increases. I'm talking about the cutting knife. I'm talking about the shaving blade. The life increases. With these two things, one is a formation of austenite getting converted to a strong and hard martensite, and formation of carbide particles, the life of the material, cut useful life of the material, gets extended. The application can be essentially, basically, to tool industries. You're talking about a complicated machine tool. Talk about lathe machine or a drilling machine or a milling machine. This tool, after some time, it becomes worn out. It becomes somewhat blunt. So what is being done is the tool is taken out. It is sharpened again. It has to be fixed back to the tool. Tool post. I'm talking about the lathe machine. But in this called as tool life is lost, because you are taking out the Too cool. Sharpening it, and there's a possibility that you may not get the right location, the way it was clamped earlier. So the machine shutdown time is more if it is not, you know, if it is frequently taken out for sharpening or increasing the life, or you know, giving life to the cutting tool. But cryogenic treatment, what happens is this cutting life, you know, the useful life, it gets increased, so the shutdown of the machine is reduced. So it has got bearing on the cost effectiveness. So a lot of advantages with the cryogenic treatment, but there is a point to be noted. The shutdown of the machine can be reduced, but the cost of getting material cryotreated, you know, it gets compensated. But I'm talking about the advantages precisely. See, this is the schematic diagram of the process, or the process indicator diagram of the cryotreatment process. It can be, you can see there are three phases here. One is the left side, a pressurized liquid nitrogen container and the liquid nitrogen supply manifold. At the center, you can see the cryotreatment unit, and the right top corner, you can see the data acquisition system. Essentially, I am collecting data using a computer with a proper developed software. See, now you can see this is a pressurized liquid nitrogen container, which is having a capacity of holding around 250 liters of liquid nitrogen. So what is a pressurized liquid nitrogen container? This is essentially this is nothing but a thermos flask, a big thermos flask, you can say, where I am pouring liquid nitrogen into this, which is maintained at the temperature for days together. There are the possibilities of heat in leak, but all the heat in leak are minimized thanks to the insulation inside. And when I'm exposing it to room temperature, what happens is liquid nitrogen boils, and this liquid nitrogen comes out, goes like this, and enters into this cryotreatment unit. So you can see here there's a control wall. It passes through like this. There is a solenoid wall. You can see this is a solenoid wall. What is solenoid wall? It is not manually controlled. It gets switched on, switched off, switched on, switched off, on or off kind of operation, and it enters into this cryotreatment unit. And this is a PID controller. And here, what the configuration of this cryotreatment unit? So now this is a tabletop model. There is a cylindrical unit, outer container and inner container, or outer vessel or the inner vessel, made up of SS316. The space between them is packed with the polyurethane foam so that the heat in leak is minimized. And on the top, there is a cover. This cover is also double walled, and the space between the inner surface and the outer surface is packed with polyurethane foam. So the entire cryotreatment unit is ensured that heat in leak is minimized. Now the question is, I'm allowing liquid nitrogen to enter here, and you can see there is a tank. I'm talking about it is a buffer tank. So nitrogen enters here, it fills up and just goes to the atmosphere. At the center, you can see there is a motor and there's a shaft, and the other side of the shaft, you can see a fan blade. When the motor starts, the fan blades also, they start rotating. So this inner space, this is the space where I'm putting the materials to be cryotreated. For example, I'm talking about the tools or any material. I'm going to pack them, and there is a perforated tray, 11th one. This liquid nitrogen, when it is here, the temperature will be around 93 or 94 Kelvin. When the fan rotates, then it's going to pick up the cold. It pushes it down. It goes to the sides and enters into the backside of the fan. So you can see a formation of a closed loop force convection current inside. Again, you can see here, there is a cylindrical shroud here around which I have got copper coil wound from the top to the bottom. So this liquid nitrogen is made to get, you know, I'm drilling a hole, taking out liquid nitrogen, making it to move around the shroud, and finally taken out to the atmosphere. The point to be noted is, from both the ways, you know, one is by a buffer tank, I'm going with the indirect cooling. I'm talking about force convection, natural current, force convection current to induce cold to the specimens. And in case if it's not possible if it is, you know, if to overcome the situation that each and every material, each and everything is being cooled, I'm allowing the liquid nitrogen to move around this. So from both the ways, I'm cooling the material to cryogenic temperature and it is taken out to the atmosphere. Now question is, why there are so many walls? So this is initially containing air. So what I do is liquid nitrogen, which is going out, right? I close this wall. So liquid nitrogen doesn't go outside. I'll open this wall. Nitrogen enters here. I'm talking about at the room temperature. It gets, you know, converted into vapor. It gets converted to gas. And I'm allowing it to go out to the atmosphere. So the entire space is filled up with dry nitrogen gas. So there is no problem of any moisture. Even after I complete my cryotreatment process after 36 hours, you cannot see even a single drop inside the cryotreatment unit because it is totally filled with the dry nitrogen gas. And this one you can see, I'm talking about 4 and 5. What you can see here is, this is called as a PID controller. And this is going to, I'm having P-tended sensors. It is going to measure the temperature. And this is based on the temperature which is going to be sensed by P-tended, it's sent to PID controller. This PID controller, which is programmed, activates the solenoid valve on and off. Whenever it is on, liquid nitrogen comes here. When it is off, it gets switched off. So what happens is, I have to gradually cool the specimens to 93 Kelvin for that matter. I'm talking about -194 degrees centigrade, something like that. So it has to be gradually cooled. So what should happen is, at every fall of temperature, you know, there's a guideline, right? After every 3 minutes, the temperature should fall down by 1 degree centigrade. Every 6 minutes, again, 1 degree centigrade. So that way I'm starting from room temperature 300 Kelvin to I go up to 95 Kelvin. So what happens, supposing the liquid nitrogen supply is more, then what happens, this PID controller is going to sense the temperature, it switches off solenoid valve. If it is less, it allows the solenoid valve to open. If it is more, it switches off. So on, off, so continuously. The gradual fall in the temperature from room to 95 Kelvin is taken care of with the help of PID controller and solenoid valve, which is operated by PID controller. And this data is continuously recorded using a data acquisition system. I'm talking about data acquisition system, but it is a computer linked with the software to the system. I'm showing some photographs. As I told, this is a tabletop kind of a cryotreatment unit. The fourth one you can see, this looks almost like a pressure cooker. On the top, you can see the motor, you can see the pressure relief valve. This is the pressure gauge. This is the pressure relief valve. And this liquid nitrogen inlet, liquid nitrogen outlet. And this one is the top cover. I can open this, fill up the materials, close this and clamp with the screw. So the entire system is packed. This top you can see, this is the buffer tank. This is the buffer tank. And this is the shroud. And you can see some copper coil. And you can see here in this figure, in this photograph, a shroud is surrounded by copper coil. So nitrogen enters here. It moves round and round. And the material is inside. And at the end, it is taken up. So I'm ensuring that each and every location inside the cryotreatment unit, inside this, is exposed to low temperature. This is the assembled view in the open condition. This is how it looks. When it's assembled, it is taken out totally. The volume of this one is around 30 liters. So you can keep specimens, whether it we talk about copper blocks, or you can talk about tools or carbide tools or HSS, whatever it is, I can feed so many things into this for cryogenic treatment. This is another photograph. You can see this is everything is insulated, like liquid nitrogen enters here. There is a control valve. This is a pressure relief valve. Again, this is a pressure relief valve. This is the PID controller. This is a cryogenic solenoid valve. This is from a company called as Honeywell. This is from Oxford Instrument. This is going to just sense a signal, either it is on or off, on or off. And this is the photograph of the entire cryo treatment process, where there is a liquid nitrogen container for 230 liter capacity, which self-pressurizing type. When the pressure crosses, right, when I open, then liquid nitrogen, because the pressure developed inside, it comes out, goes into system. And you can see there is a plastic pipe which is sent to the atmosphere around, because if it is allowed to recirculate inside the room, it can give rise to, you know, a replacement of oxygen, asphyxiation, and so many other, you know, safety issues. So what are the advantages or what are the salient features of this cryo-treatment system? One is no direct contact of liquid nitrogen with specimen. Essentially, I'm talking about I'm not exposing or I'm not putting all any material tool in dipping into liquid nitrogen. It's going to be an indirect process. Secondly, efficient transfer of cold to the specimen for two reasons. One is, you know, natural forced convection of temperature reduction. Then using copper coil to make it to low, I mean you get it exposed to low temperature directly around the shroud. Then capacity to cryo-treat large number of samples in a single batch, something like a refrigerator. You can keep milk, you can keep vegetables, you can keep fruits. That way, one cryo-treatment cycle I can conduct various experiments with various different objectives, and option of various cooling, soaking, and warm-up rates because of the PID controller with the program. It has got about 16 programs which you can check, you can change. It can be 3 hours cooling, it can be 6 hours cooling, 24 hours of soak or 36, whatever, depending upon the situation. And easy movement of the nitrogen, but I'm not saying easy movement, I'm not saying it is going to be mounted on the caster mounted wheels, but you can locally shift from one place to another place inside the department. So now, let me speak about, having spoken about what is cryogenic treatment, how it looks, what is the background of theoretical background of this, how actual cryo-treatment system looks like and all the things. Let me talk about various experiments which are completed and we got encouraging results. See, one thing I can tell you clearly, the scope is enormous. Whatever you think, whether it is going to a cryo-treatment can help it, yes, it can be explored. Two good things can happen with cryogenic treatment. One is, yes, it can show good results. If not, nothing happens. So it's no, there's going to be nothing like a degradation or deterioration of the basic property. So that's where we have an edge. So scope is tremendous. I'm talking about some tool states, HSS tools or carbide tools. I mean, application, depending upon the case, we can proceed. So the first one is performance of integral diaphragm pressure transducers for propellant pressure measurement. So our project was funded by the Department of Space, ISRO, and our objective was basically to take care of the needs of their objectives. So we'll start one after the other. You can see here, this is the pictorial view of an integral diaphragm pressure transducer. So what is a transducer? Transducer is a instrument kind of a thing where input in one form is converted into output in another form. From the bottom, in that red arrow which was going up, I am applying propellant. What is propellant? Propellant is a mixture of liquid hydrogen as a fuel and liquid oxygen as an oxidizer. When they're mixed together, it's called as propellant. This is going to be applied from the bottom. And you can see this is an integral diaphragm pressure transducer made up of APX4 precipitation, hardened Martin static stainless steel. What is this? A single rod. I'm removing the metal from the top, I'm removing the metal from the bottom, and at the center you can see there is a diaphragm of a very small thickness, about 2 millimeters or so, and I'm mounting a strain going onto this. And when I apply the pressure at the center, what should happen is, because the diaphragm is very thin, it should bulge. And now I'm mounting a strain gauge at the center, so more zero pressure, no output, the diaphragm is not going to bulge at all. Whereas as the pressure increases, this diaphragm starts bulging. The length of the strain, the length of the wire and the strain gauge increases. If this is energized, so it shows the strain and the changes in the electrical output. So with the increase in pressure, I'm in a position to measure, or just increase in pressure or whatever the pressure, I'm in a position to note down the strain induced in the strain gauge, which gets converted into electrical signal. So this basically used for measurement of the propellant pressures. The problem is like this. Why we wanted to create this diaphragm? It was basically, I'm talking about precipitation hardened martensitic steel. Martensite is basically strong and hard, which should contain 100% martensite. But unfortunately, the produced or the available martensitic APX4, martensitic precipitation hardened stainless steel, was containing around 94% martensite and around 6% austenite, which is soft and ductile, which in course of time, running in months, this austenite also is called as retained austenite, or else I can call it as unwanted austenite, gets converted into martensite, which has got a different coefficient of volumetric expansion. So when this austenite gets converted to martensite and this one comes to the scene, there's going to be a differential expansion of the diaphragm. So it loses its homogeneity, or else it loses its dimensional stability. Because of the differential difference in the coefficient of volumetric expansion, there is going to be distortion on the surface. So when you mount the strain gauge, probably after length, after a year or two, the reliability may not be quite good. If it is coming to, you know, movement of the vehicles on the road, I need not worry much, but this is basically a very, very critical application. They can't take any chance. So they wanted us to convert all the austenite to martensite. So what is 94% martensite and 6% austenite? They wanted before they started machining, before they started this operation, it should be 100% martensite only. So our effort was to convert this retained austenite around 6% to 100%, totally everything wanted to be martensite. So this one, the other figure I'm showing here is effect of residual stresses. Now, initially the diaphragm was having its own defects inside, even though it looks very pleasant, very symmetrical left side. If see the right side, there are so many voids, there are gaps, there are discontinuities, and so many irregularities. So cryogenic treatment gives rise to formation of carbide particles, filling up the entire volume, making it compact, dense, and strong. So what was happening is this residual stress was another factor which was to be reduced. The problem was like this: because of austenite getting converted to martensite, there was unwanted stress which was induced in the diaphragm. So there were cases when there was no input, also it was showing an output because of the residual stress. So cryogenic treatment was aimed at two objectives. One is conversion of retained austenite to martensite, and second one is eliminating all the residual stresses. Probably maybe asking like, what is residual stress, whether it's good or bad? Good one way, bad the other way. You're talking about stainless steel, which has got roughly, you know, the yield strength is about 750 megapascals, any metal for that matter. If there is residual stress of about 390 megapascals inside due to work hardening or due to machining or due to, you know, the metal being poured into the casting, what happens is already stress is there. So you induce much more stress, then it reaches that point of 750, it loses its useful life, or as the useful life, the metal comes down. And the fatigue length also effectively will come down. So what should happen? It should be started. We should minimize the residual stress. If it is 400, it should be made to come down to zero as much as possible, so that you can start applying the stress and the life of that material can be used for a longer length of time. Nothing like if it's going to be material for subjected to tensile loading, if it has got residual compressive stress or negative stresses, it's going to be an advantage, because you have to apply the pressure from minus, it should come to zero, then from zero it should go up and reach 750 megapascal. So residual stress, it does play a very, very important role. So when you conduct experiments in UTM, probably you'll be thinking there's no stress at all. You start from zero, it is not zero, there will be already a stress. So you are filling up the gap going up to the yield point. So what happened here in the case of martensitic stainless steel? Let us look into the composition. It is carbon 0.06, chromium 16%, nickel 4%, molybdenum 1%, and balance is iron. Chromium is the one which is going to give rise to the property of a stainless steel, which is anti-corrosive, and unaffected by, you know, heat. Higher temperatures. Properties: tensile strength is 1200 megapascals, percentage elongation is 16, impact strength is 100 joules per centimeter square. Tensile strength normally should be around 700 or 800, but this is a martensitic stainless steel, quite strong, and hence you can see it is about 1200 megapascals. So what we did? We determined the residual strength and retained austenite of the raw material, number one. Then we conducted cryogenic treatment at 98 Kelvin for 36 hours. That is 36 plus 3 hours of cooling and 9 hours of warming up. Then the entire materials which were cryotreated were subjected to tempering in a vacuum furnace at 510 degrees centigrade for 3 hours. Like, take it out from the cryotreatment unit, immediately put into the vacuum furnace so that there's no oxidation taking place. Then again, determine the residual stress and retained austenite level. see the changes, then test, then go for final assembly. Anyway, our point of focus is ending with the determination of residual stress and it rained austenite. Observe the changes, and yes, our objective, we have to study the changes. Testing and final assembly is the lookout of LPSC ISRO. So what happens? We had five batches. Each batch had about six samples. So we'll see residual stresses. Initially, it was minus 286. After cryogenic treatment and tempering, it improved to minus 170. Did not come to zero. Let me say this clearly. So everywhere which is around minus 280, minus 360, it came down to minus 100. And so in other words, the improvement in the residual stress was 37%, 57%, 62, 58, and 60, around 50% on an average. You can see the residual stress has been reduced. This residual stress is measured with the help of X-ray diffraction techniques, thanks to CPRI. Second one is retained austenite. As I told you, it should have been 100% Martin set, but unfortunately, certain amount of retained austenite is there. So when you talk about the batch one, before cryogenic treatment, it was austenite was 6.8. It means 100 minus 6.8 was the Martin site. Now, after cryogenic treatment and tempering, the 6.8 became 2.55. It means there is conversion of austenite to Martin site. So it's almost approaching 100% Martin site. In many batches, 6.35 to 3.55, 6.95 to 3. So we started with the experiments where the cryo treatment was taken for 24 hours. Then we could not get good encouraging results. Again, we continued 36 hours. Yes, it gave encouraging results. But if you say that you could have exposed the metals to still higher, I mean, longer length of time, 48 hours, no, it doesn't give encouraging results. So we reached the peak. So we defined our cycle as a cryogenic treatment for these materials, EPX4. 36 hours of cryogenic treatment at 98 Kelvin, we have got quite encouraging results. Now, where studies on of HSS tools, M42 tools, tool. The composition is molybdenum 9.5, tungsten, chromium, carbon 1.1%, cobalt 8%, vanadium. Where is the application of this HSS tool, molybdenum based high speed steel tool, HSS tool? This is used for machining exhaust nozzles of rockets made up of columbium. Let us see like this. A rocket has got exhaust nozzles, which has to be exposed to a very, you know, it has to have the compatibility to withstand very, very high temperature, because it has to withstand the exhaust of the rocket. High temperature, 1300 or 1400 degrees centigrade, and the material also that exhaust nozzle should be strong enough not to melt or deform itself, which is made up of a columbium material. To machine this tough material, columbium, equally tough tool has to be there. So they were using M42, but what happened was both the material and the tool were equally strong. They used to form a lot of built up, you know, edge or gumming effect, or the material, the tool getting stuck inside the material, columbium material. So this was a problem. So many repeatedly the tool was to be taken out, sharpened again, inserted to the tool post. Again, it's the grinding system in the machining used to start. So what we did was we took out this M42 HSS tool, cryotreated, and see how much would be improvement in the wear resistance property, or else how much we can contribute to reducing the shutdown of the machine or increasing the tool life. You can see here, this is ASTM standard G99 in their 1995. So this is what is the disc, which is mounted on a motor, abrasive disc, and there is a pin here, and I'm applying the load to the other side, fulcrum. So what happens is, you can just imagine if this is mounted on, and this is tightly, firmly, you know, held against a rotating grinding wheel. If this pin is made up of wax, and I'm applying load here, and I'm rotating this for 10 minutes at a particular speed, if it is made up of wax, it wears out very fast. If it is lead, it wears out somewhat less. If it is copper, it wears out still less. If it is steel, still less. And if it is tool, it's going to be still much more less. So in other words, now this pin, the reduction in the length of this pin, supposing if it is 20 millimeter, in this case, it is 8, length is 4 inches. If this length of this tool reduces, more it reduces, the resistance prop wear resistance is less. If it is reducing less, the wear resistance property is quite good. So we did this tool was M40HS tools, 3 by 16 by 36 by 16 into 4 inches. This is a square kind of a cutting tool. Grinding wheel was 4 millimeter thick, 8 millimeter diameter. This is the signature of the grinding wheel, abrasive grinding wheel made up of carborundum universal. 20 newtons was applied, 20 newtons essentially 2 kgs. Grinding wheel was rotating at 400 rpm. True track radius was 20 millimeter. In other words, this is the axis. This radius was 20 millimeters, and the test was conducted for 10 minutes. So before cryogenic treatment, how much is the wear? How much is reduction in the length? 4 inches. After cryogenic treatment, how much is the change in length? That's what we wanted to study. You can see this is the pictorial view of a pin on disc wear testing apparatus. So what happened is, which can measure both frictional force and the total wear. So here you can see the experiment was conducted for 10 minutes, 600 seconds. So this blue color is the one which is for the tool which was cryogenically treated. The red one was with, the one which we purchased from the market. So here the wear frictional force was more. In the other case, cryogenic treated material to tool, the frictional force was less. If the frictional force is less, the friction is less, the tool wear is less, because the tool and the material internal, in surface, the temperature produced because of friction is less. So the life somewhat increases, improves, because the frictional force is less. It's a smooth operation. But when it comes to wear results, you can observe that red one, okay, which was untreated raw material, in other words, the tool which was purchased from the market. So you can see here after 600 seconds or 600 seconds, 10 minutes, it had worn by 80 microns, whereas the cryo-treated HSS tool, it started wearing, it hardly came to around 50 microns. In other words, it was not wearing at all, still about 60 to 70 seconds, or in other words, almost a minute, nothing was happening. But whereas in the case of untreated HSS tool, it started wearing. So you can see minimum, a reduction in the wear property, reduction in the wear, what I'm saying, reduction wear in the tool which was exposed to cryogenic treatment. So hence we can see that wear resistance improves when a material, when a tool or anything is exposed to cryogenic treatment cycle. And then mechanical properties of materials. So this is another objective. We took it for a space technology cell. This is a material. This is basically a Russian material, 07X16H6. This is used for wall materials for liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen cryogenic engines. You can see it is somewhat similar, or some of the properties are almost similar to SS316, but it's not SS316. It is almost similar to that. Composition is 0.05 to 0.09 carbon, chromium. You can see there's a major contribution, 15 to 17. This gives rise to the properties of stainless steel, heat and wear resistance property, nickel and other things, and ultimately iron, which is the balance. So we divided this material into 4 batches: raw material, which is purchased from the market in the annealed condition, cryogenic treatment alone at 98 Kelvin for 24 hours, then batch C cryo treatment at 98 Kelvin for 24 hours, followed by tempering at 400 Kelvin, so mean Celsius, for 1 hour. Then fourth batch, that is batch D, austenitization at 990 Celsius for 1 hour, followed by cryo treatment at 98 Kelvin for 24 hours, followed by tempering at 400 Celsius for 1 hour. So it can be seen like this. First batch, batch A, the material which was procured from the market in annealed condition. Batch B, only cryo treatment at 98 Kelvin for 24 hours. Batch C, cryo treatment and tempering. Batch D, left side as well as right side of the cryo treatment process, austenitization at 990 Celsius. So basically, you're taking the material to the original condition, heat it up to that temperature, then allow it to cool down, immediately subject to cryogenic treatment, and immediately temper it at 400 Celsius for 1 hour. So it's a continuous process. It is not after austenitization, it comes room temperature, I wait for a couple of days, start my cryo treatment. It's not so. It has to be a continuous process. The moment it's taken out from the cryo treatment unit, it should be subjected to tempering without any time loss. So what are the changes which we could see? So tensile strength properties, batch A, raw condition, it was 1954. Let us see one after the other. Ultimate tensile strength, it was 1954. Just cryogenic treatment did not give encouraging results. It, in fact, got reduced. Whereas batch C, cryo treatment followed by tempering, it gave rise to enhanced from 1954 to 1987. But the fourth case where it was austenitized at 99 and 90 degrees centigrade, cryotreated and tempered, it gave significant improvement in the strength properties. So what was 1954 went up to 2509, 1901. Of course, yield strength is somewhat less compared to ultimate tensile strength. What was 1901, it went up to 2404. Percentage elongation, definitely when it is 17.8, if it has become hard and strong in the case of D, the percentage elongation definitely comes down. That's what you can see proportionally. And hardness, it was 35 initially. After cryogenic treatment, it went up to 37. After cryogenic treatment and tempering, again, it went up to 38. And the last process, that means the batch D, which was austenitized, cryotreated, and tempered, there was significant improvement in the hardness. Impact strength, initially it was 47, 50.4, 27 and 23.4. Well, let us be clear about this. As the strength and hardness increases, the impact strength reduces. That's what we can see in the tabular column. The fourth application of cryogenic treatment was wear properties of automobile brake discs. We took two brake discs. One from Bajaj Kawasaki, another one is from Hero Honda brake discs. Never call them as Bajaj Kawasaki, or we never call them as Hero Honda two-wheeler brake discs. We call them as A and B. Let me talk about which is A, which is B. But how a brake system works in an automobile, I'm talking about a two-wheeler. The wheel is mounted or attached here with four bolts and nuts here. This is the hub. This is a piston. I'm applying the force. I'm applying the brake. What happens is this piston pushes the brake pads, one from this side and the linkage mechanism the other side. So it is pressed. When you apply the brake, the piston moves. This is also brought together. And this is the brake disc and it is retarded. It is brought to zero condition. So now the wear property of this rotor brake disc is very, very important, because if it starts wearing, then the braking efficiency will definitely come down. It can be definitely very dangerous also. So let us look into two types of brake discs, disc A and disc B. One is two competitors, Bajaj and Hero Honda. The composition basically was same. 13.5 chromium, manganese, silicon, nickel, carbon, phosphorus, and iron. Iron was a balance, of course. If you see the picture, they're slightly different. They're slightly different. This is the surface. This is the brake disc surface where the brake, the brake pads, they come in contact with this and apply the produce the braking action. You can see many holes here. Why there are holes here? Because if when the vehicle is moving, and if there is any dirt particle, if there is stone or pebbles, anything like that, if it gets locked, braking may not be proper. So these holes, they wash out all the unwanted debris, which can give rise to a lot of abrasion and other things. So when we see what all happened, we started with the preparation of the test specimens. We measure the wear and hardness of both the brake discs. They were cryotreated for 8 hours and measurements of wear and hardness. At the same time, we extended the length of cryotreatment process for 24 hours. Again, we saw what are the measurements we measured, wear and hardness. So we compared and studied what are the changes. Obviously, one thing was quite indicative, cryogenic treatment at 8 hours and cryogenic treatment at 24 hours. 24 hours, as we expected, it should give rise to better results of wear and hardness, because more than the lower temperature which you achieve during cryogenic treatment, it is the duration of time that plays a very, very important role here. So now you can see this was the way we did for the M42 tool. The loading was 92 newtons, in other words, around 10 kgs. Grinding disc RPM was 300 RPM. tool track radius was 150 millimeters and the test duration was 1200 seconds, that is 20 minutes. So, I mean, this harness, earlier it was Brinell harness, in this case it was HRC with a diamond cone and with the major load of 1500 newtons and a minor load of 98 newtons, and the indenter was 120 degrees spiroconical diamond. Because this is a harder material, we had to proceed with the HRC. Probably you are aware of determining the hardness, major load, apply the major load, then minor load, release, that kind of a thing. So the results are like this. Break disc A, untreated, it had a HRC of 35.93. Cryotreated, it was more. And cryotreatment for 24 hours, it had again increased. Hardness had increased for both the break disc A or break disc B. So clearly indicating that cryotreatment enhances the hardness. May not be that significant, but when you think about the wear resistance property, untreated, yes, it has worn by 175 microns in 20 minutes, but cryotreatment, it has worn by only 68 microns. Cryotreatment for 24 hours, again, it improved by, it came down to 45, it again got reduced. Same way for break B also. So clearly you can expect changes in the wear resistance properties. Whereas in the case of break A, cryotreatment could give rise to very encouraging results, whereas break B, yes, it has given rise to, but the way it came from 175 to 45, it did not come from 135 to 102, it came from 135, from 0 to, what I'm saying is the enhancement was up to 24%. So effectively, I'm talking about cryogenic treatment on cycles. What is cryogenic treatment on cycles? Cryogenic treatment on materials. Taking a material to cryogenic temperature at 77 Kelvin or on that temperature, soaking it for a long length of time and bringing it to room temperature. In the case of steel, what happens is during cryogenic treatment, austenite gets converted to martensite, carbide particles are released, and any material, whether copper or aluminum or stainless steel or titanium, the atoms are brought together, they are locked, and once they go up to room temperature, these locked atoms, they do not release. So hence a dense compact structure is produced, which is permanent in nature. We have talked about various studies which we carried out. One was the reduction in the residual stress and wear properties of reduction residual stress and conversion of retained austenite in the case of integral diaphragm pressure transducers. Then enhancement in tool properties of HSS tool M42 molybdenum based high speed steel tool. Then the third one is mechanical properties, APX4, Russian material, how much the mechanical properties changed after cryogenic treatment. And the fourth one was the changes in wear resistance and hardness properties of a brake disc, of automobile brake disc. So with this, let me go to the last slide, which is quite interesting. Thank you very much. Dinesh, I'm through.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Dinesh.
Wait. Mithapa, sir?
Yes.
Yeah.
Sir?
Yes, it's forward to you, sir. Mithapa.
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Durgesh, for sharing your knowledge and experience on cryogenic treatment on metals. Now this session is open for the participants for query. You may unmute and ask the questions or drop in the chat box.
Shall I mute or?
No, sir.
Mute.
In the chat box, there are some questions, sir.
Okay, I think that's okay.
Question from Kiran.
Mm-hmm.
When ferrous EN19 material under treatment and cryogenic treatment separately, what will be the hardness and surface morphology between treatments, and what kind of mechanical property will going to change?
Okay. I'm putting it like this. This whole subject of heat treatment is very vast, and case to case it varies. We cannot predict what can be the changes expected, what are the numerical values, or what are the changes which can be numerically arrived at this condition. If we can conduct the experiments, of course, we've got our treatment system with us. We conduct the experiments, we can see what are the changes with the experiments, with actual tests, with the standard labs, then only we can arrive at conclusive conditions. Yes, I welcome, it's definitely an opening, it's opening for a new idea. It can be conducted. I mean, we have to conduct the cryotreatment trials, then only we can arrive at the conclusion. But yes, as I told you, right? Metallurgical changes, yes. Carbide particles, they precipitate, and the metal becomes homogeneous, it's compact. Other effects you can see. But the problem is like this: if you have got two materials which are cryotreated, which are not cryotreated, they look the same. I mean, appearance is they almost, for the naked eyes, they look the same. So you cannot make out which is cryotreated or which is not cryotreated. Yeah.
Yes, thank you, sir. And one more participant has raised the hand. That is Mrudula Prashant.
Pardon me?
Mrudula Prashant. You can ask the question, Mrudula Prashant. Unmute yourself and I can ask the question.
Sir, now my question is, whenever you are trying to, that is, go through the cycle of cryogenic treatment.
Yeah.
So how do you control the rate of cooling?
Uh-huh.
Say, for example, you say for some time we say 2 degrees per minute, right? Or 3 degrees.
Yes. Yeah.
Or so. Or, and along with that, whenever your holding time is for 24 hours or 36 hours, how do you control this process? Ah,
okay, madam. I think I can answer your question like this. Now, let us say now the temperature is 300 degrees centigrade. Okay, let us assume it is 300 degrees centigrade. Now I would like to go to 300 Kelvin to 98 Kelvin. Now I would like to go ahead with, a 3 hours cool down time. Are you with me?
Yes, I'm with you.
Okay, so 3 hours. So 300 Kelvin to 98 Kelvin. 300 minus 98, you get this, correct?
Yes, sir.
You get one value. 300 minus 98, that is 202. And now 3 hours time, correct? 3 hours time is 180 minutes, correct? So divide one by the other. So you'll come to know every 2 degrees centigrade, how much should we fall in temperature? I think I'm clear, no?
Yeah.
So now what I do is, this PID controller has got a program. You can set the program so that the temperature, indicative temperature from 300 Kelvin, it is taken down to 98 Kelvin in say 3 hours or 180 minutes. So if you put it like this, every 2.5 minutes or something like that, the temperature fall down. So now I switch on the system. What happens? 300 Kelvin. After two, I'm giving just an example. After 1.5 minutes, it should come to 299. After 2 minutes, again, it should come to 298 or something like that, I'm telling, right? So now this is an indicative reading, right? So whereas this is the temperature to follow, and this PID controller has got a program. You can program the PID controller where it can be, it has to maintain the temperature at a particular temperature, cryogenic temperature, for 24 hours. So what it does, it is going to switch on, basically this PID controller is going to, give rise to the direction, but depending upon the temperature of the PT100, it's going to activate the solenoid wall and allow the liquid nitrogen to flow in and out. I can give an analogy like this. If you have to travel from point A to point B, right? You have got multiple milestones, correct? After 15 minutes, if the journey is for 1 hour, after 15 minutes, I should be here. After half an hour, I should be here. Supposing you are ahead of time, what happens? You will apply brakes and you'll wait for some time. If you are slow, you'll accelerate. So that way, this PID controller will be activating the solenoid wall so that the liquid nitrogen is released and sent to the cryotreatment unit depending upon the temperature which is inside the cryotreatment unit. I think you are clear about my answer.
Yeah. Well, I have one more question to ask. So how does this cryogenic treatment behave with respect to non-ferrous materials?
Non-ferrous materials application as such has not been much, actually. I don't expect much of changes. In fact, we tried on Teflon. Frankly speaking, nothing happened. So, see, I'm telling you, madam, one thing is there. I'm not a magician, or cryotreatment is not, you know, solution to all the problems on this earth. It works, it works. It doesn't work, it doesn't work. But effectively, it works on metallic materials, alloys or copper, you know, where atoms react to the temperature that way.
That's what I was asking about, if it is on copper, if it is on aluminium.
Yes, you're right. I am totally agreeing with you. Yes. Plastic materials, no. Not much of change. Many times it will remain the same. Not many times.
Hello.
Yes, please.
I just lost the network. Sorry. I meant on non-ferrous materials.
Yes. Non-ferrous materials, I'm telling you, in the case of steel, you know, carbide particles are released, understandable. But in the case of non-ferrous metals, let me give an example. OFHC copper, oxygen-free, high-conductivity copper. It is a copper which is totally free from all the impurities. There is nothing, you know, trapped oxygen or trapped air, anything like that. It's a compact material, OFHC. We tried to see the changes of, I did not show this, in this presentation. OFHC, we try to see the thermal conductivity properties. Okay.
So the voice is breaking. Hello.
Very good, conductor of heat. So it, shrunk properly as the temperature was brought down. The atoms got interlocked. Then when you, the atoms become closer to each other. And when the temperature was brought to room temperature, it was irreversible. What was locked, it remained locked only. So we could expect good results in the case of, but this is the only way. Is the only way. Thermal conductivity increase or mechanical property increase. That's the other things you can see. In the case of non-ferrous metals. Whereas, see, when you talk about engineering metals, you can also appreciate this. 70% of the materials are almost, steel only, stainless steel, various grades of stainless steel. That.
Sir, one more thing.
Yes. No. I'm not minding. Please tell me.
If in case we are adding some alloying materials to the copper, yes. I will try to get the properties.
Yes. I understand. But how much is the percentage of alloying material, madam? Hardly anything. It may not make much of difference. Even if it is going to be an alloying material, as long as it is metal by itself, it doesn't play a role. And every experiment, it is case to case. We cannot generalize. See, I'm talking about SS304. I purchased from one particular vendor. The properties are different. So we proceed with various kinds of averages. Where I'm saying it is 1200 megapascals, we tried on 5 samples, we arrived at the ultimate strength is 1200 megapascal. It's not, we cannot generalize. So everything is case to case study.
So you mean to say we can try out also?
Yes, but one trial, it takes about 4 months totally. Because you have to determine the initial properties. Cryogenic treatment, it's just about 2 days work. Again, you have to go for metallurgical studies, that kind of a thing. It is going to be, so anything. Yes, our system is ready.
Thanks a lot.
Okay.
Maybe I may seek your help.
No, definitely. And in fact, our Nagendra from, he's our Jnanendra's, Jnanesh's friend also. No, I'm there.
Okay, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. There are more questions, sir. Can I read those questions?
And then how many questions are there, you can tell me?
2-3 are there, sir.
Okay, fine. Not, I thought dozens of questions, not like that, no?
Okay.
Yeah.
There is one more question from Suresh Kumar. Subjecting materials to low temperature, does material become brittle and hard in every case?
Hardness and brittle is a very tricky word, I can tell you. Diamond is hard, brittle, but it is not strong. Chalk piece, it is hard and brittle, it is not strong. But in the case of cryogenic treatment, it becomes hard. Hardness speaks about brittleness and strong. Yes. It becomes hard and strong.
Okay, sir. And one more. From Dr. Sinappa. Where do we get experimental facility to get cryogenic treatment for metals apart from IASC?
Okay. If you are to spend money, right? IASC, what happens like this? We have to conduct the experiment not for, you know, when there is a project, we have to we conduct the experiment. Then once I am conducting the experiment, definitely I have no issues, you know. You can give materials, I can cryogenically treat and hand it over to you. But these are as per my terms and conditions. In a sense, if I am going for a cryo treatment cycle of 24 hours, you know, now 3 hours of cooling, you know, you have to accept that. But if you want to dictate your terms, you know, there is a cryo treatment unit in Hosur near, you know, Bangalore, Tumkur. I mean, what that? Tamil Nadu. The details are available in the website, cryogenic treatment facility in the Hosur, you know. There he will, you know, as per your needs, he can, you know, credit it and give, and charges, I think, in rupees per kg, something like that. I have not gone there, but yes, it is there. Because many people, you know, they who come to me, then, you know, they got examination next month or something, then what to do? I mean, they normally go there. I direct them there.
Yes.
The details are available on the website.
Okay. And another question from Dayanand Gowder.
Yes, please.
What is the criteria for cooling rate?
I am not talking about the see, point to be noted like this. It cannot be dipped into, or anything cannot be dipped into liquid nitrogen, because it's going to give rise to thermal shock, and there can be immediately hardness on the external surface. So it should be gradually cooled to cryogenic temperature, but doesn't speak about, I mean, 3 hours is, you know, I initially I was also very, you know, spectacle about this. I had to cool in about 8 hours, slowly started coming down. Now 3 hours of cooling by and large does, I mean, it gives rise to good results. But one thing, more than the cooling and more than the warming rate, what is important is the soak time. You can expect some results for 16 hours of soak. You can expect better results for 24 hours of soak. You can expect still better results after 36 hours, but there is an optimum value. You cannot go on cryo treatment cycle where, you know, it is soaked for 100 hours or something. There's no point in that. So by and large, 24 hours, yes, or 36 hours. The duration plays a major role. So what I'm saying is, more than going to the lowest temperature, it is the duration that plays a role. That plays, you know, a very influencing effect.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
And what is the approximate cost for setting up this cryogenic treatment setup?
Around 10 lakhs. No, not. Okay. Yes, around 10 lakhs. Yes. If you know, because it includes a liquid nitrogen container. Of course, they're available in India now for about 2 lakhs. The cryo treatment unit to develop and all, it's going to be around 5 lakhs, solenoid wall, then PID controller, you know, roughly if you are having about 10 lakhs, you are very safe.
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you.
I can put it like this. 8 is minimum.
Okay.
10 is maximum.
Okay. Sir. Thank you. I hope you have cleared all the doubts of our participants. Now I request Professor Vidappa, sir, to conclude this session. Vidappa, sir?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Please conclude this session, sir. And before that,
thank you, sir.
Please kindly give your feedback. Okay, that link is provided in the chat box. Thank you. Go ahead, sir. Vidappa, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, sir, for being the speaker of this session in spite of a busy schedule. I request all the participants to fill the feedback form. I thank all the participants for joining the session. We shall meet in the afternoon session on superconductor coils and motors by Mr. VVAS Muralidhar, Manager, VHCL, Hyderabad. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Yes, sir. Nadik, sir?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Vidappa, it's over.
Yes, sir. You can.
Okay. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dhyanesh. Dhyanesh Vadapan says your friend is there, Nagendra. So somehow I'm not able to overcome that. Dhyanendra, Nagendra, like that. Anyway, nice. It was nice. You know? Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Dear participants. Please kindly fill your feedback and please join the afternoon session exactly at 3 o'clock. It is about superconducting coils and motors by BVS Muralidhar, who is a manager in R&D wing, BHEL, Hyderabad. Okay. Kindly fill your feedback.